We exalt your name, Lord. We praise you. We praise Adonai. From the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Praise Adonai. All the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. With one voice, we praise Adonai. From the rising of the sun till the end of every day. Praise Adonai. All the nations of the earth, all the angels and the saints sing praise. We praise the Lord.
That I would be set free.
down for me. I sing for all that you've done for me. Thank you, Lord, for all you've done for us in our lives, amen. If you can go ahead and take your seat here.
Get some adjustment things adjusted here. For those, we've had some questions since last week about masks and whether the church is requiring them or not. It's the county that's requiring them. But we do have to follow the laws of the land as long as they don't violate God's laws. The main purpose of the mask, the same reason why a surgeon wears a mask when he's in the operating room, was to keep his germs from contaminating someone else. And in Philippians 2:3, it tells us to value others higher than ourselves. So, and personally, I will not miss out on a gathering of God's people just because I don't want to wear a mask for an hour and a half a week. But the county site where they have the new law does have some exceptions to that, that you can go online and look at and see if you fit into that. And, you know, they don't have requirements for asking for that kind of stuff, but we do need to try to follow the county guidelines as much as possible. So, you know, personally, people need to go look at those guidelines, see if you are exempt from that. I've looked at them. I don't feel like I am exempt, so I will wear a mask to protect you and my wife. My wife is the one, the biggest one, because I'm out and about more than she is. So it's more likely that I will bring it home to her through work or somewhere else more than anything else. I do work from home, but I do have to occasionally go in sometimes. So that's enough about the masks. Teachers, children's church teachers, we're planning to have a Zoom meeting on July 2nd at 7 p.m. And Pastor Danny will be sending out a text message on Monday about the meeting, some of the things we need to talk about. And if you've got something you'd like to put on the agenda, that would be the time to respond to him so that we'll have it all together and ready for the meeting on July 2nd at 7 p.m. Part of this is to see what we need to do to try to get Children's Church started up again, at least for some of the older ones. Baptisms. We are going to have Terry and Sue be baptized on July 5th, which is next Sunday. They've been through the classes and stuff, and they were supposed to be baptized like 3 months ago, but due to all of this that has come about, it got kind of postponed, so they feel like they're ready to do that. We also went ahead and set up a time for classes on the August 30th and November 1st, and then with baptism scheduled on September 13th and November 15th for anyone else that might like to get baptized and have not been through the classes. So if you're one of those people, contact the church through any of the pastors or any of the rest of the staff and let us know, and we'll get back to you and see about getting the classes set up. The fellowship for July 3rd. Pastor found out that there is no fireworks at night, so we are going to go ahead and cancel it. That was part of the main reason for having the thing. So with everything kind of in the up thick right now, it was decided to go ahead and cancel that fellowship. So we will still have services on Wednesday and on Sunday, so feel more than welcome to come to those. I think that's all I've got in the announcements. So we'll put the turn it over to Pastor Rick. Oh, I better leave the microphone for him. That way the people online can hear. So, thank you.
Let me get set up now. Amen. Well, I'm glad to see you guys here today, this morning. How's everybody doing? Everybody doing well? All right. So we're going to get into the next part of the book of John. We're going to be in chapter 11. We're going to go through a few verses. And before we do that, I just want you guys, you know, as you guys all know here, we, as the people of God, need the Word of God. Amen? And we don't need necessarily the wisdom of man or our insights, you know, what we think might be the correct thing to say. We're a church that believes that God's Word is the ultimate authority. We're a church that believes that it's relevant for our lives today. Amen. As it was over 2,000 years ago. And we're a Bible-believing, teaching, preaching, cherishing church. Amen. So we don't want to portray a God to you that is a figment of our imagination in any way, shape, or form. We want to show him to you the way he is clearly described through his word. Amen. So we're going to go through this today. We're in no way, by any means, perfect in sharing, amen, but as God gives us wisdom, as God gives us guidance, as God empowers us by his Holy Spirit to give us the utterance, the things to say, amen, may we be those here this morning that would have ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord has to say, amen. So, in that way, we want to honor him, amen, by teaching and preaching his word. So we're going to be in the book of John. Again, I'm going to read from chapter 11. We're going to go from verses 1, and we are going to end up in verse 16. And I know when Pastor asked me a couple weeks ago, you know, hey, can you go ahead and go chapter 11, verse 1 through, I think he said like 44. I'm like, I can't do that. I will try and get as far as I can get, and I've gotten as far as verse 16, amen? So that's where we're going to be today, and I pray that this is encouraging to you. I know it's relevant for us today. It's a topic that we may look at in the sense of how we view God. Some people may have the wrong view of God in the things that are described in this chapter as far as the way he responded to a need. Amen. So let's go ahead and read. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sister sent to him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you, and you're going there again? And Jesus answered, Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. These things he said to them after he had said to them, our friend Lazarus sleeps, but I go that I may wake him up. So here he's saying, hey guys, our friend Lazarus has died. Then his disciples said, Lord, if he sleeps, he will get well. However, Jesus spoke of his death, but they thought that he was speaking about taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus said to them plainly, and here it is, Lazarus is dead. And I am glad, Jesus says, for your sakes that I was not there, that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go to him. Then Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you this morning. We thank you, God, that we can look to your word. God, and your word speaks to us. I pray, God, that as we go through these passages in the book of John, as we have been going through the book of John for many weeks now, we have seen the things that Jesus has done, the miraculous, the supernatural, the unexplainable, the impossible made possible. And Lord, I pray that you would enlighten us, God, to your word this morning, that we may hear what the Spirit has to say to us. God, we believe that your word is the ultimate authority. God, may every man be a liar and you be true. Lord God, we give you reign this morning. Speak to us, Lord God. Your servants are listening. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. So in the beginning, in the absolute beginning, was the Word. Amen. And the Word is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the Word was with God, and the Word of God, His glory, the glory of the Son, from the Father, full of grace and truth. And from His fullness, we received grace upon grace. And because He was in the beginning, because He is God, and therefore He is infinitely great beyond all of our imagination, beyond all that we can imagine or think, He exceeds it all. He is the most important reality in our world today. Amen? He is the most important reality that encompasses the things that we go through. Amen? The horrors of this disease, this pandemic, COVID-19, the things that are going on around the world with social injustice and the things that are happening all around us here in not just the United States, but everywhere that we turn. We hear of things, we see things, we know that there's an agenda, and ultimately the enemy is at work. He is at work to destroy. The Bible says that the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus came to give life and give it in abundance. To give life so that we can live it to the fullest. Amen. Are we living that life to the fullest this morning? Or are we living that life in fear? Are we living that life in not understanding or knowing or kind of running into roadblocks? And there's going to be roadblocks in our lives. There are going to be things that happen. There's going to be tragedy that happens. Amen? But how do we respond when those things take place? And because Jesus became flesh and lived this human life and suffered and died and rose again, He is in Himself able to encompass, explain, put right, and comfort us personally, intimately, and tenderly, the loss of every individual life, amen, including the life of George Floyd, including the life of this young man that recently passed here, Carlos Ingram Lopez, and every person who has ever existed that has passed on, even you and I, we are going to no longer exist one day in human flesh, amen. And there's going to be this pain. There's going to be this void that someone else is going to feel. But how do we respond to Christ in the midst of it? And see, Jesus, he does some things here that, quite frankly, would be, some people can look at this passage and say, man, they're calling for Jesus to come and help. But Jesus is doing something different here. Jesus is intentionally doing something here. He's doing things throughout the book of John that John records, and we're going to see here this morning exactly to what outcome this was for. Amen. Ultimately, our lives are not our own. Ultimately, our lives are in Christ. Amen. The Bible said it is no longer the I that live, but Christ that lives in me. So if Christ lives in you, ultimately there's an end that we can understand and come to know that we will be with him. Amen. Yes, there's pain. Yes, there's suffering. And that is a result of sin in our world. Amen. That will not go away. Amen. And you can be the most spiritual person. You can be the most well-versed person in Scripture. You can be someone who just has this been, you know, you've been saved for a very long time and you have this awesome relationship with Christ. But when tragedy strikes, when the pain comes, it's real. Amen. It's real. And yes, you can have joy in knowing that certain things are taking place at the moment of your pain. In the middle of the turmoil, we can understand that Christ, amen, can give us that peace that surpasses all understanding, amen, and give us that joy. And it's only when we understand his love and how he demonstrates his love for us and to us, amen. So this is our God who we worship. Amen. This is the one, Jesus Christ, infinite in his divine majesty and as close and caring as a mother would be to her little child. Amen. That's how he is towards us. And we are gathered to worship him in his word. We're not gathered as a school to hear a lecture, but as a royal priesthood. Amen. A holy nation, a people of his own possession, to hear the word from our King, from our Savior, Jesus Christ. A word about suffering, a word about death, a word about love, and a word about the glory of God. And this is where we're going to be. We're going to talk about suffering and death. We're going to talk about love, and we're going to talk about his glory and how all of these three things relate to each other. Suffering, love, and the glory of Christ. And this is where we're at in the book of John now, in chapter 11. And this is what he has to say to us. And it is very, very relevant. So our text is in John, again, chapter 11, verses 1 through 16. But just before this chapter begins, the crowds in Jerusalem had picked up stones to kill Jesus. And we see these disciples of Christ telling him, hey, why do we want to go back over there? Don't you remember they wanted to stone you for the things that you were saying and the things that, you know, people were seeing being done? And that was in John chapter 10, verse 31. And in verse 38, they tried to arrest him, but he escaped. And he travels east and north and crosses the Jordan. And before long, Mary and Martha, his friends from Bethany, amen, that was near Jerusalem, sent word to Jesus that their brother Lazarus was very sick. So that's the setting here for Jesus' amazing words about death and love and the glory of God. And as I read verses 1 through 6, listen for those three things: death, love, and glory. And listen for their relationship. This is our King shaping the way we see the word, or do we see the world, amen, of death and of love, and the way we feel about the horrors and the beauties that happen in the world. Perhaps these words will turn your world upside down. John 11, verses 1 and 2 says, now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, The village of Mary and her sister Martha. This was Mary who anointed Jesus' feet with ointment and wiped it with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. And what's remarkable about that verse right there is that that event hadn't even happened yet. And yet this statement is being made. That happens in chapter 12. So here, I believe this is just showing us this intimacy, this relationship, this closeness, this friendship that Jesus has with these people here. And how special of a relationship that they do have that exists between Mary and Jesus, even though that evidence is yet to come as she anoints his feet later on in chapter 12. The point is this, she's not a stranger. There's an unusual love between her and Jesus. And some people might get confused about, you know, Mary, the one that came and wiped Jesus' feet with her tears and other books of the Bible. Amen. But I believe these are two different Marys. I believe one was probably Mary Magdalene, and this one is Mary of Bethany. Amen. But nevertheless, we see that there's this intimacy that takes place. We see that there's this closeness that she has. And if you guys remember when Jesus came to teach at their feet, who was sitting at the foot of Jesus when Martha and Mary were preparing the place? Amen. Who was it? It was Mary. Jesus says, Martha, you know, you're busy doing all this other stuff, but she's chosen the better place to sit. So here, there is this relationship that is taking place. It's a closeness, and she is reaching out to a very close and dear friend, someone who that she admires so much. How many of us here admire our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? How many of us know that he is closer than a friend? Amen. He calls us his friends. You know, I believe when Jesus was here on earth, I believe Jesus had fun. Amen. I believe that, you know, he wasn't a picture of our imagination the way we can probably picture him, right? Of this just whole, I mean, extremely holy. Of course he was. But, I mean, I can just picture him, you know, playing ball with the disciples, you know, just having fun, being a guy, right? Being a friend, being, you know, someone that everybody looked up to. And this is the type of relationship that he has with his people. This is the type of relationship he wants to have with us. Amen. But in verse 3, it says, so the sister sent him saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. So that's a statement there of the love that Christ has for his friend. And John is showing us something here. And we can even look at, you know, the statement that, you know, that is made throughout other chapters, other verses about John himself. Amen. About the one whom you love. So Jesus has this love for Lazarus. He loves him. So now John makes it explicit. He wants us to see and feel that Jesus has this type of love for this family that we're talking about. This request is for help. It's not coming from a casual acquaintance, okay? It's coming from the closest circle of Jesus' friends. Verse 4 says, but when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death, but it is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. The first thing Jesus does when he hears the news of Lazarus' illness is put it in relation to the glory of God and his own glory. As soon as he hears it, he puts it into relation of the glory of God. It's for the glory of God. I mean, could he have freaked out and said, oh man, we got to get up and we got to go. My friend's sick. And you guys, if you guys think about this, so the Bible says that he stayed 2 extra days. Okay? But the Bible says that when he got there, Lazarus had already been dead for 4 days. So if Jesus would have left that day, by the time he would have gotten there from where he was at, it would have taken him 2 days to get there. So Lazarus would have already have been dead at that moment for 2 days. Okay, just kind of a little thing to put out there. But it's a plea for help. It's a plea for urgency. But this illness is about God's glory. It's about the glory of the Son of God. It's not mainly about death, though he will die. And he does die. And Jesus knows that he's going to die. He makes that statement with his disciples. But it's mainly about God, about the Son of God, and about how glorious God and his Son are. This is what Jesus says in verse 4, this illness does not lead to death. The point of this illness is not death, but it's for the glory of God, so that the Son of Man may be glorified through it. And I think that we miss that in our lives. I think that we miss the fact that for those who live in Christ, to die is what? To die is gain. So if you are in Christ and you pass on, that is a gain. Amen. Even though it's a loss for us that feel it. Amen. For those that experience it, it is a gain. It is a gain, and we need to start seeing things the way God sees things. Amen. But that's very difficult, isn't it? It's harder said than done. But is it impossible? No, it's not. And this is just like chapter 9 where the man was born blind, remember? And because he sinned, not because he sinned or that his parents had sinned, but so that the works of God may be manifested in John chapter 9 verses 3 and 4. You guys remember that? Why was this man born blind? Some say that maybe it's because he's a sinner. Some say maybe it's because his parents were sinners. And Jesus makes that statement, says, no, it's so that you can see the glory of God. That's why he was born blind. And then what happens? He gives sight to the blind man. Amen? Why? We're going to see that here. There's a purpose behind Jesus' decision making, all right? And it's difficult for us to see sometimes, but it's there. Only here the issue is going to be that of death. It's not blindness. Not just blindness or illness. Lazarus, he's going to die. Jesus knows this. In fact, he chooses for Lazarus to die. And we'll see it in just a moment here. Now, John underlines for the third time the love that Jesus has for this family in verse 5. It says, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So John really wants us to see and feel this. Three times he says it in this short amount of time here. In verse 2 it says, this woman whom anointed Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. In verse 3, the one whom you loved is ill. You love him. In verse 5, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So Jesus makes these statements three times. And surely John is stressing Jesus' love here for this family because he knows that what Jesus is about is to do here, what he's about to do here does not feel like love to most people. Most people will read that and say, well, that doesn't sound like love. Man, they cry out to him, and Jesus is saying, the one whom he loves, the sisters whom he loves, Lazarus whom he loves. Yeah, he says, I'm going to just chill here for a couple more days. Would most people, when they read that, think that is love? No, most people would say, well, love would be to just go and do it right then and there, right? To go perform that miracle. I mean, there's nothing limiting Jesus. He's God, right? And they know and they've heard and they've seen that the miracles that Jesus had performed in the earlier chapters of John, right? All these miracles that he performed were for a purpose. And that purpose was to bring glory to God. That purpose was to bring people to Christ. That purpose was to have people believe, amen, in the Son of God. But nobody thinks of love this way. Amen? Apart from the Spirit of God changing our hearts to see what love really is in this text. This is why I said that this text can shape or turn our world upside down if we see it the way it is, intended to be seen. And John knows what he is about to say in verse 6 goes against all ordinary human experience where God is not supreme. And the key word that unlocks the shock is the word so. At the beginning of this verse in verse 6, it's really there in the original text. Amen. In the Greek and the Hebrew, it means therefore. So verse 5 and 6 read like this. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So, or therefore, when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Jesus knew what this would mean, this delay. It would mean the certainty of Lazarus' death. We know this because in verse 14, when Jesus decides to go to Bethany, he knows Lazarus is already dead. Then Jesus told them plainly, remember, Lazarus has died. But Jesus is choosing to let Lazarus die, or to make sure that he is what? That he is very dead. All right? Remember, he could have been there 2 days earlier and he still would have been dead 2 days. But he's waiting a couple more days, and now, you know, the stench is there, and I mean, the decay is taking place, and it's bad news. Okay? Even though the body's been anointed like it would be in tradition, especially for a guy like Lazarus that had many friends, I mean, an acquaintance, not just an acquaintance, but a very good friend of Jesus. Amen. I can just imagine this guy's burial was one that had many people there. Seemed like a really good friend to many. Amen. And you might say, well, maybe that's not that bad, because after all, we know that Jesus could raise him from the dead. But consider two things here. Lazarus really died. It's not an easy thing to die, okay? And as far as Lazarus knew, Jesus did not come. Jesus didn't show up. And his sisters saw him die. So that was a difficult thing. And they buried him and they wondered, where was Jesus? Can you just picture that? Man, we called for him and he didn't come. Where were you? So this was real death. This was real loss. And Jesus, he didn't show up to stop it. And he did it intentionally. And the way that John presents this story, he means for us to see the resurrection of Lazarus as a picture of our resurrection. Amen? The resurrection of all those whom believe in him. Because one day we will too be resurrected to life. Amen? The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be what? Present with the Lord. See, my son was asking me yesterday, Angel, he's like, you know, what happens, like, how, you know, when you die, is there like a place, or like, what about people that died a long time ago, like before Jesus even came to earth? Like, what happens to them? And I said, son, you got to understand one thing with, and this is difficult to understand, okay, because we're limited to time and space. Our reality is, okay, it's, what time is it right now? It's 11:10 or 11:15, whatever that time is. All right, and about 60 seconds from now, it's going to be 11:16, right? I got to go work tomorrow, so I got so many hours in the rest of this day to prepare for that. So we're limited to time and space. With God, God is not limited to time and space. With God, it says that, like, A thousand years is like a day to him, or even less than that. Amen? So God isn't limited to time and space. So the next moment in our lives, amen, is in the presence of God. When you pass on from this place, your very next breath, amen, is going to be in the presence of God. Some will be raised to everlasting life, and some to everlasting condemnation, depending on where your faith was placed. Amen? So that's the difference here, okay? That's what happens. It's the resurrection, and it's a picture of ultimately what Jesus is going to do. It's a setup, okay? Listen to Jesus in verses 23 and 26. Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise again in the last day and at the resurrection." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he will die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." In other words, my raising your brother is just what will happen to everyone who believes in me. So Jesus is painting a picture here. This is for this reason. This is what's happening. This means that the way you think about Lazarus' death is this. The death of Lazarus was real and terrible, and it's going to be just as terrible as ours, okay? Just as terrible as you've experienced with people that you love to have passed on. And if you think his was less terrible because Jesus raised him, the truth is your death will not be any more terrible than his. Because too, you will be raised in that day. You will be raised by Jesus. The only difference is time. Because we live in the realm of time and space. All right? Some of us are like, whew. Does that make sense to you guys? Are you guys following along here? And the amount of time between your death and the resurrection are nothing, nothing compared to eternity. To nothing. You guys remember that illustration that Francis Chan did where he pulls out that rope, right? He pulls out a string. I'll just put it this way. Maybe I can do this here. So this is eternity, okay? Just picture this. This portion of is eternity, okay? Or actually, I'm going to say eternity goes on. On. There's no end, okay? Our life is right here. That's where we're at. That's where we're limited to. So it pales in comparison to eternity. Amen. That's why we need to put our faith and trust in Christ, because we want to be raised to life. Amen. In that last day. And that last day could be different for everybody. All right? Some of us will last till Christ, comes back for his people. Some of us will pass on. Some of us may get sick. Some of us may die from old age. Some of us will, things might happen. Tragedy might strike. I don't know. I'm not God, but I do know what I see. Amen. I do know the reality that we live and we die. Amen. But eternity is where it matters. And Jesus is showing them something here. It's about that. It's about how many people I can bring to this. Not here. And many of us live our lives right here. And we just live it there. And we live it for the moment. And we live it for temporary things. And we live it for ourselves. But we have no idea. We do not even think about eternity until it's brought up. Or until we go through something and sin happens in our life and we feel the consequences of it. But why not live our lives with this in mind? Eternity. That's where it matters. Because we're all going to be there. We're all going to live. We are all eternal beings, okay? And if we're going to live here, where do we want to spend it? With Christ. In His presence, in heaven, in glory, not apart from Him. And we think the suffering now of death and the pain of that is bad. Man, can you imagine eternity without Christ? We can't even begin to imagine it. And we can't even begin to imagine all the glories that we will be experiencing with Christ at the same time. Right? We're limited to our thinking until Christ gives us that, wow, here you are in His presence. So it's about eternity. And now perhaps we are prepared to see and feel the main point here. It was love that moved Jesus to let Lazarus die. It was love of Jesus, the love of Jesus for this family and for His disciples and for you and for me that are reading this text that caused them to choose to let Lazarus die. Look again at the connection between verses 5 and 6. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sisters and Lazarus. Therefore, because of this love, when He had heard Lazarus was ill, He stayed 2 days longer in the place where He was. He didn't hurry to His side. And in writing, John intends, and Jesus intends, for everyone seeing this to ask, how is this love? John has gone out of his way here for us to be set up here, okay? Jesus loves them. He loves them. He wants us to see this. Therefore, He does not heal him, but He lets him die. Why is this love? Jesus has given us the answer loud and clear, and it will give it again in verse 15. He said in verse 4, this illness does not lead to death. In other words, the point of this is not death. It's for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. This illness will turn out for the glory of God and the glory of the Son of God. This illness will put the glory of God on display. And that's exactly what it did. It put it on display. It put it on full blast. Okay? You think we see things nowadays, you know, because everybody's got their cameras out, right? Everybody's got their phones out when things are happening. And man, everybody's on display, right? And that's even more so now than ever before. And I mean, there's a lot of things I can say about that. There's a lot of things I can say about, censoring and just like privacy and all that kind of stuff. Because ultimately, guys, if you guys think about this, all eyes are on us, right? Even right now. I mean, we're on Facebook Live. All eyes are on us. So yeah, you guys remember seeing movies back in the day about, security and privacy and satellites, watching people. And that's the reality we live in today. I mean, flip open your laptop and man, if you got a little camera on there, who knows? Who knows who's viewing what? Amen. Who knows who's seeing what you're going through? But again, this is put on display here. His death was put on display for the glory of God. Therefore, verse 6, love lets him die. Love lets him die because his death will help them see in more ways that they know. It's to see the glory of God. So what is love? What does it mean to be loved by Jesus? Love means giving us what we need most. Giving us what we need most. And what do we need most is not healing, but a full and endless experience of the glory of God. Love means giving us what will bring us the fullest and longest joy. And what is that? What will give you full and eternal joy? The answer of this text is clear: a revelation to your soul of the glory of God. Seeing, admiring, and marveling at the Savior, Jesus Christ. When someone is willing to die or to let your brother die to give you that, he loves you. So God was willing to send his own son for us to die in our place because he loves us. Because he doesn't want to spend eternity apart from his creation. Amen. Love is doing whatever you have to do to help people see and treasure the glory of God. And that's the supreme joy. Amen. To help people see and be satisfied with God's glory. Look at the way Jesus says it in verses 14 and 15. He says, "Then Jesus told them plainly, 'Lazarus has died. And for your sake, I'm glad that I was not there so that you may believe.'" So that you may believe. The human counterpart to this revelation of God's glory is what? It's believing. I've done this. I didn't heal him. He died so that you would believe. So why is he tying in this? Was there still some doubt? Yes, there was. Jesus knows who his audience is. These are his disciples. These are the guys that are intimately spending time with him. Okay? And he's telling them, "Hey guys, I didn't go." All right, when they came and told me, first of all, he would have been dead anyway. All right? He's not saying that because he knows all things. He knows all things. That's why he's telling them this. He knows their heart. He knows that they weren't at that point yet. Right? So he needed, all right, to allow this to happen so that they would believe. Believe in what? Believe that Jesus can raise people from the dead? No. And if that's the way you're thinking about it, you got it all wrong. Believing is coming to Jesus to be satisfied with all that God is for us in Christ. And we come to him the only way that we see his glory. It says this: we beheld his glory. The glory is the only Son of the Father, full of grace and truth. And that's in John chapter 1, verse 14. So these are two great purposes of all things: God demonstration of his glory in Christ, and human beings treasuring that glory above all things. That is the meaning of life and of all creation. It's for God's glory. When God created the heavens and the earth, when God created, Adam and Eve, when God, throughout all of creation, of his creation, what was it for? It was for his glory. It was for him. It was so that he could be revealed in all of it. So people that, when my son asked, "Well, what about those people that died before, Christ came to the earth, and they're probably like in other countries and other places?" I said, "Well, God, even in his creation, right, demonstrates and shows himself so that people are without excuse." So God, He's most glorified, amen, when we are most satisfied with him. So how do you become more satisfied with Christ? You have to have a relationship, first of all. Okay? It can't be just a casual thing. And so many people that believe in Jesus Christ are casual Christians. It's just a casual thing. It's just like I casually go on a date, or I casually go out to eat at a special place. I don't do it all the time. And many people's relationship with Christ is just like that. It's special at that moment, right? Like when we talk about, I go to church on Christmas, or I go to church on Easter, right? You see more people come in on those days than just normal days. Why? Because that's a casual relationship that they have. And that could even be true for those who are always here. You could be here every week and still have a casual encounter with Christ. And that's all it is. It's not meaningful. It's not rich. It's not deep. You're not experiencing this relationship for the glory of God. But if you are, and this is what Christ is trying to show us here, He's doing all this. He's allowing this to happen so that we could see that it's for His glory. Everything that is done is for the glory of God. Why we breathe, why we live, why we walk about, why we go to work, everything is for Him. Everything. So Jesus lets Lazarus die to show the glory of God and to intensify the faith of not only His disciples, but of many people that will hear and see when they were there when Christ raised him out of that grave. And many people believed. And many people believed. And the main point of today's text is this: it's love. And the aim of love is to bring people to the fullest knowledge, the fullest enjoyment of the glory of God. Jesus didn't just let Lazarus die for this. He died for what? For a picture of what was to come. Christ suffered once for sins, for the righteous, for the unrighteous, that He might bring us to God. 1 Peter chapter 3:18. And Jesus prayed that on the other side of His death, His redeemed people would see His glory. Where He says, "I desire they also whom You have given Me may be with Me where I am to see My glory." And that's in John 17:24. So what is love? Love is the longing that labors and suffers to bring others with what is infinitely the eternal satisfaction of the glory of God. Let me end with this last thing. Between the death of Lazarus and his resurrection 4 days later, his family could not see how God would be glorified in it. That would be revealed at his resurrection. Therefore, if that is where you stand today, and all of us do, in some sense, not seeing clearly how God is glorified in the death of those that we love, don't judge before the resurrection, amen. God is doing more than we can know. God is doing so much more than we can even know. And the resurrection will bring it all to light. In the meantime, in the interim, trust in Him. Believe on Him. And treasure Him above all things. And if you do that, man, you're going to see when things happen, you're going to see Christ in a different light. Amen? See, we see Christ when we want to see Him and how we want to see Him. But Christ, He went through all the things that we went through. He experienced pain just like we experienced pain. He went through everything imaginable, even more, when all the sin of the world was placed upon Him. Can you imagine that feeling? You can't. All right? You can't. You cannot. But He does. And He knows. And He can sympathize with us. And He knows what it feels like. You know, the shortest passage of the Bible, Jesus wept. Right? So does He feel? Yes, of course He feels. Yes, He can sympathize with us. Yes, He knows what we go through. He knows what you're going through right now. And if you're going through a storm, if you're going through a trial in your life right now, and it's maybe apart from COVID-19, let's not make that the center of our lives, okay? Even though the world wants you to make that the center right now. See, the world and the enemy, all right? Remember, who's in charge of this? It's the prince and the power of the air, all right? It's Satan himself, all right? He's over the media waves. He's over the, he's everywhere, right? There's puppets everywhere, right? And man, we can be right along with everybody else going with the flow. But Christ hasn't called us to go with the flow, amen? And I've said this before, he's called us to go against that. He wants us to swim upstream or against the current, amen? And the current of this world is telling you, you need to do this, you need to believe this way, you know, you need to, you know, just do what makes you happy. Do what pleases you. That's where we live. We live in a world that is so about self. You know, that's why everybody doing whatever the heck they want. Why? Because they can. Because they can. Because morality, because, you know, what's right and what's wrong, you know, it's like thrown out the window. Do whatever you want. Whatever makes you happy, whatever, you know, floats your boat, right? Do that. You know, if you want to change your sexuality, go ahead and do that. Man, we'll put a sign on the restroom door that says, whatever you want to be, come on in. Right? On top of everything else that's out there. But man, let me tell you one thing. When you experience tragedy, and I know we've all gone through something, we've all experienced it in some way, shape, or form, man, start just trusting in what God is doing. Try that. Try it. Try just to place your trust. God, I don't understand it right now. God, it doesn't feel good, but I'm just going to trust you. I'm just going to trust you. God, I don't understand why you didn't heal. God, I don't understand why you why that was allowed, but God, I'm just going to trust you. There's a greater purpose behind that, God, and I don't know what it is right now, but I'm going to trust you. Why? Because it's for the glory of God, and we start seeing him in that way, in the way he loves us, amen? Because ultimately, again, he did it all for us, and he demonstrated his own love towards us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And that's the cross. That's the gospel. Amen? That's it. The end of the day, that's what it's all about. It's about his glory bringing us with him. Amen? Let's stand up and pray. Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you that you know what you're doing, first of all. We may not know. We may not understand it. But God, we know that you're in control. Even when things seem out of control, Lord God, help us just to place our trust in you and give us that sense of understanding, Lord God. And God, give people in here and even people watching online a sense of urgency, even more so as the day approaches, Lord, to come to you. Lord, not just to say a prayer, not just to say, I accept you into my life, Christ, but God, to really examine themselves, Lord, and if there's any sin that needs to be dealt with, that they would repent of it, Lord God, that they would turn for their wicked ways, Lord, and trust in you, like they would trust in a parachute, Lord God. So if you're watching, if you're listening to my voice right now, and you've never received Christ as your Lord and Savior, maybe you have and you've backslidden. Man, maybe you were never saved to begin with. I don't know. But if you want to be saved, if you want to have Christ in your life, if you want to spend eternity with him, not apart from him, yes, we may not understand everything and why all things happen, but we can just trust him. If that's you today, I want you just to repeat this after me. But make it real. Make it about an everyday step closer to God, that you're going to commit yourself to do things differently, not just think that this is going to be some magic experience that changes you automatically and that's the way it's going to be. No, you have to do your part. God already did his part. He sent his son on, born of a virgin, lived the sinless life, died on the cross for our sins, and raised from the dead so that we can be with him in eternity. So if that's you, just repeat after me. And you even in here, repeat after me. Father, I realize that I am a sinner. God, I know you dealt with my sin on the cross. Help me to see myself the way you see me. Lord, I turn from my sin today, and I will trust in you as my Savior. Help me every day to live a life to the fullest in you. Help me to have a relationship with you. Send your Spirit to live in me and help me to experience that life to the fullest. In Jesus' name. And Lord, I thank you again for what you're doing in this place. And we just pray, God, that you would comfort those who have experienced loss, God, and help them to see your glory. In Jesus' name. And the Church of God says, amen and amen. Amen. Give him praise. Amen. Amen. We are dismissed, and I just hope that you guys have a great week. If you have any questions about anything, just go ahead and ask, and praise the Lord. We're dismissed.